إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث إذ أرسلنا فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء قالوا ما بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء إن أنتم إلا تكذبون قالوا رَبُّنَا يَعْلَمُ إِنَّا إِلَيْكُمْ لَمُرْسَلُونَ وَمَا عَلَيْنَا قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم قالوا طائركم معكم قالوا طائركم معكم قالوا طائركم معكم أين ذكرتم بل أنتم قوم مسرفون وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى وَجَاءَ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ رَجُلٌ يَسْعَى قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ اتَّبِعُوا مَنْ لَا يَسْأَلُكُمْ أَجْرًا وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فطرني وإليه ترجعون أتخذ من دونه آلهة وما لي لا فطرني وإليه ترجعون أتخذ من دونه شفاعتهم شيئا لا تغني عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين قيل ادخل الجنة قيل ادخل الجنة قيل ادخل الجنة قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي وجعلني من المكرمين صدق الله مولانا العلي العظيم
MashaAllah, Karyanas, what a beautiful recitation. What a beautiful recitation. MashaAllah. Over to you, Imam Tariq.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. As-salatu was-salamu ala Rasulullah. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Today we reflect on Surah Yasin. We're all familiar with Surah Yasin. Surah Yasin is a surah that is universally adored and loved by the ummah, by the Muslims everywhere. No matter, you know, what age or what background someone has, somehow, when we hear Surah Yasin, it touches our hearts. And that actually speaks of the miraculousness of the Quran, that it can fall upon a heart and revive it and resuscitate it. And indeed, we hear beautiful traditions mentioned about Surah Yasin. In a couple of authentic narrations, Rasulullah ﷺ speaking of the power of the surah and its impact, indeed, on hearts, you know, he said, recite this surah upon those who are departing from this life, dying. And that's actually a significant and profound reminder, again, of the impact of the surah, that in this most critical time in one's journey, which turns out to be the theme of the surah. The theme of the surah is actually the journey back to Allah Azza wa Jal, which is one of the most central and fundamental themes of our lives, just to develop this awareness and this realization that we're to Allah we belong and to Allah we return. If we don't submit to this, we missed out on all truth. So this surah is a reminder about this and a reminder about the power of Allah to resurrect and to bring out of, you know, to bring the living out of the dead and to resurrect decomposed bodies, because Allah possesses infinite power. So Rasulullah ﷺ says, in that time, when someone is transitioning from this world into the next world, and there is no harder moment in one's journey, because it's a moment in which you're separating from all the joys, all the pleasures, all the things that you've loved in your journey, including your family. What a difficult, tragic moment, right? So Rasulullah ﷺ says, while this person is experiencing this moment of separation, the best thing to do for them is to recite Surah Yasin for them while they're experiencing these pangs of death, right? And it's supposed to deliver comfort and ease to them as they experience that transition. And it's subhanAllah, it's a common tradition that we recite it for them before they leave. And after they're dead, we recite Surah Yasin, following that beautiful tradition, reminder from Rasulullah ﷺ. Now, there is another beautiful hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, where he said also, whoever recites Surah Yasin in a night, Allah shall forgive their sins. Allah shall forgive their sins. And the scholars comment on both of these ahadith, and they said, these two ahadith show us that indeed, if Surah Yasin is a surah that we recite upon someone experiencing death, then shouldn't we be reciting Surah Yasin for any affliction or adversity in our lives? Meaning that if you encounter any challenge, any struggle in your life, any pain, any insurmountable issue that you're struggling with, it doesn't matter. If you're constricted emotionally, spiritually, physically, then Rasulullah ﷺ says, read Surah Yasin and invoke Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah will relieve you. And Allah will grant you full forgiveness. So it's one of those surahs, definitely, that speaks to our hearts, but it contains incredible gems and an incredible bounty and blessing for Allah, for you and me. And it's, you know, a good time to recite it in these days, because we're dealing with a difficulty in our lives and because we're in the month of Ramadan. I want to focus on a beautiful passage in the surah that is also relevant to our lives and relevant to some of our struggles. You know, beginning with verse 13, and we heard in the beautiful recitation of our dear brother Anas, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions a story that becomes a highlight in this surah, embedded with this larger theme of the journey back to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's a story about a town to which Allah sent two messengers. So Allah is keen to send his messengers to his creation and to, you know, to remind them and make them witness the truth of Allah Azza wa Jal. We need reminding. So he sent them two messengers, highlighting the significance of being reminded. Now, these people turned out to be very stubborn and difficult people. So these two messengers were not sent to normal people. They were sent to very corrupt community. And they give him a hard time. They made fun of them. They ridiculed them. They threatened them. So Allah bolstered their efforts by sending a third messenger. which again reminds us and shows us something beautiful about Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah will not leave us without a reminding. And the message of Allah is so important that He is ready to send not one messenger, not two, but multiple messengers to deliver His guidance, even if people are stubborn. And no matter how what it takes, this message of Allah Azza wa Jalla on this earth is so profound and is so precious that Allah will do anything to ensure that it's delivered to every heart and every soul. So these, the three messengers, similarly, it didn't yield any greater outcome. And the community continued to give them a hard time and persecute them. Now, at the end of their journey, you can imagine, like, you know, you were sent on a mission and you were like supposed to convince one or two individuals. And you failed at that. How do you feel about this? You feel like you're a failure. These three messengers were sent to a town and no one in that town accepted the truth from them. How do they feel about themselves? SubhanAllah. And yet Allah is mentioning them. Turns out that these three messengers, because why would Allah mention them here if the entire town rejected them? The entire town rejected them. And by the way, none of these people from that town believed. Like even later, like in the story of Yunus alayhi salam, when Yunus departed in wrath, when he returned back after being swallowed by the fish and Allah made him, you know, brought him back to his town, he found the whole town to believe in Allah Azza wa Jalla, bounty of Allah. But in this case, they didn't believe. So in terms of success rate, these three messages had zero success rate, yet they are mentioned in the surah. Why is that? Turns out, so they're talking to the community, they're very being very merciful and caring, and no one accepted. Their interest were on the people in that town. Guess what happens? Allah blesses the efforts. Little did they know that their words and their guidance did not necessarily touch the hearts of the people around them, but the words rippled out outside of the town. And Allah picks up the rest of the story saying, وَجَاءَ مِنْ أَقْصَى الْمَدِينَةِ رَجُلُ يَسْعَى. Their message, brothers and sisters, touched one heart of one man, not in the town, in the outskirts of the town. Did they mean to talk to that man? No, they didn't. But somehow the story of the three messengers rippled out of the town by the blessing and the power of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah will take your efforts, my efforts, our words, if they're sincere, make them ripple out. And it touched the heart of a man. And guess what this man did? He's a simple, poor man. He heard of the story of these three messages. He said, Ya SubhanAllah, this is amazing. I mean, it's something that I have to submit to. La ilaha illallah. He believed instantly. But what did he do next? Because his story is mentioned in this surah and his name is immortalized. Immortalized for a reason. This man did not sit still. He was so moved by the power of the message that he picked himself up as soon as he took his shahada. As soon as he said, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, he picked himself up, got up. And instead of saying, who am I? I'm a poor man. I don't have resources. What am I going to do to help people change? You know, look at me. I don't know, have much knowledge. He picked himself up, ran, yasa, used his feet to walk to that town where the three messengers are, the town that had these people who are very abusive. And he started to talk to his people, to those people, even though he's a stranger to them. He's from the outskirts of the city. And he said, oh, my people, here's what he carried in his heart to them. He didn't come to judge them. He didn't come to condemn them. And also, he didn't find excuses not to come to them. He's a new Muslim. Yet he went straight up because he cared for them so much that he was concerned that they wouldn't believe in the message. Because once he was touched by the beauty of the message, he said, how can I not share this with my people? So he took his loving concern to them and he started to call the people of the town and they're all strangers to him. Oh people, oh my people. He literally said, as Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ya Qawmi, oh my people, oh my people. That expression indicates his loving concern for his people. He spoke out of love and affection, which is a reminder of how we need to speak to people, to our families, our friends, our communities, loving concern, not with harsh language that will turn hearts off. He said, oh, my people, why don't you listen to the messengers? These three messengers don't seek a reward from you. They're not seeking money. They're there meaning for you to embrace the truth. And this is a beautiful message. And then here's what he said. Now, I want to ask you, somebody who just became Muslim minutes ago, what knowledge does he have? Literally nothing, barely anything, yet the truth of Allah was in his heart. All he know is Allah created me. And it's exactly what he shared. He shared a simple, beautiful message with them in which he said, وَمَا لِيَ لَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي وَإِلَيْهِ تَرْجَعُونَ. He said, oh my people, why don't you listen to this message? How would I not worship someone who created me and initiated me out of nothing? That's all he said. وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. And to him we're going to return. Brothers and sisters, he summed up all Islam, all faith in one statement that is at the core of our reality. It's a statement, if we understand, we got all truth, which is, we worship Allah because He made us, and to Him we return. Two fundamental truths in this statement. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Isn't it true? This man understood it as soon as he became Muslim, and he took this profound belief and took it to his people, saying, "Believe in this because of this." A simple, beautiful argument. What did they do to him? And bear in mind again, the man did not find excuses, just as many of us do when we're trying to make efforts. We say, how can I really convince somebody who's more intelligent than me? Who am I, poor person, to go talk to these people who are intellectuals, etc., etc.? Allah says, bring your faith. Bring that to people and don't worry about the outcomes. Here's what happens next. What happens next is that his people threaten him, just as they threatened the three messengers. And they eventually kill him. They stone him to death, according to some of the traditions. Stone him to death. And Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us what happens next. He transitions into another segment in the story where he says, and he doesn't tell us how he got killed. All he says is that he was talking to his people, inviting them to believe in Allah. And suddenly in verse 26, Allah Azza wa Jalla says about him, قِيلَ دُخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. It was said to this man, enter Jannah. And then he responded by saying, oh, I wish my people knew how much Allah has forgiven me and honored me. What happened there? Allah Azza wa Jalla leaves out the details about him being killed. We didn't need to really learn anything about those details, but Allah shows us what happened to him instantly. What happened to him is that as soon as he was killed, this man who sacrificed for his people, who loved these people so much, instantly he was shown Jannah. And it was said to him, enter Jannah. And once he was immersed in the beauty of what he saw, right, he said, I wish my people knew. I wish my people knew. He's still loving his people despite the fact that they tortured him and killed him. This is a beautiful story indeed, profound story that speaks to us of the blessing of the outcomes. Allah never asks you and me to worry about the outcomes. Allah says, speak sincerely. Do your best. Don't shy away. Here's a man who came from the outskirts of the city without any knowledge. And yet his story and his name is immortalized in the Quran. Why? Because he spoke sincerely. Because he raised with his feet. Because he needed to strive. He didn't sit back and say, well, what business is it of mine to go and talk to these people? I am no one compared to the three messengers. He didn't say this. He went to aid the messengers with whatever effort he did. And it's exactly what Allah asks of us in the month of Ramadan and in all of our lives. He says, show me your best. Strive. Strive by your limbs. Strive by your tongue. Strive by your charity. Give. And when we strive with a little, the outcomes are amazing. That the name of this person is immortalized, even though, notice, none of the people believed in his message, in what he told them. No one. So his success rate is almost zero. What about the three messengers? The three messengers, their efforts produced one man. And they might even say, oh, only one man believed in us? That doesn't sound much, but it's like rate of what? One to three? One man to three messengers? But here's the kick. That man inspired generations. That man became like a beautiful tree whose fruits shed upon everybody that his name is mentioned in the Quran. How many people have been touched by this story from 1400 years ago until the end of time? Allah recorded it in the Quran to remind the three messengers and all of us, your efforts will never fail. That you and I can be sitting right now, brothers and sisters, making efforts with our families, with our children, with our community, and we're saying, oh, you know, it's failing. It's nothing is happening. Allah says, never ever think this. Allah will take your efforts if they're sincere. Multiply them beyond your imagination. You might be speaking and nobody's listening, but Allah is going to move hearts. It might not be the hearts in front of you. It might be other hearts. And then they'll ripple back maybe to the hearts that you're speaking about. The beauty of faith is to place our trust in Allah Azza wa Jalla. You throw the seed and Allah will plant it. Allah will produce trees just as He produced it for the three messengers. A star was born out of their efforts. Your efforts and my efforts are not trivial. Allah Ajal, I want to pick up finally and just highlight something beautiful about that Jannah. Because the scholars say glad tidings indeed to the believer. Because this man, because of the short life he lived, listen, this man didn't live much Islam. It was a few days, that's it. So Allah made him recover completely and he forgave him for the whole, all of his life. Because of one simple effort he made, right? When he tried to invite his people to Islam and then he was killed and Allah instantly put him in Jannah. And the scholars say, glad tidings of the believers, that Allah, as soon as you die as a believer, Allah will make you witness Jannah. And Allah will make you forget all of the pain. And Allah will immerse you completely with joy, just as he immersed this man. And indeed, Allah says in verse 56, إِنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْجَنَّةِ الْيَوْمَ فِي شُغُلٍ فَاكِهُونَ. He says, you know what's waiting for you and me? Here's what's waiting. Allah says the dwellers of Jannah today are in شُغُل فَاكِهُونَ. It means they are busy and occupied rejoicing. This is a beautiful, profound concept about Jannah. In Jannah, there is no such thing as boredom. There's no such thing as, what should I do in the next tomorrow? Because today was fun, but tomorrow, I don't know what we're going to do. Allah says you're constantly busy around the clock, every microsecond, rejoicing with joys that are unbelievable. And when you run out of joys, new joys emerge instantaneously that you never ever get bored, you never ever get tired, you never ever experience pain, suffering, grief, or fear. Enough for us to know this. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Hum wa azwajuhum fi dhilal." Not only them, you're not lonely in Jannah, but you are there with your spouses reclining on thrones of dignity, which means that the people of Jannah are never alone. The people of Jannah are reclining. And when you're reclining and chilling and, you know, drinking coffee, it means you're comfortable. Comfortable, because otherwise you wouldn't be drinking coffee, right? You're chilling. People of Jannah are constantly reclining and the foods and the drink and the fulfillment is coming to them. They don't even have to get up, which means they're in a complete state of serenity and contentment. No pain shall ever spoil it for them. Enough for us to know that this is what's waiting for us, brothers and sisters, after this long journey. And Allah concludes it by saying, Salamun qawlam min Rabbir Rahim. Peace, peace upon them. Peace of Allah. Of all things we should desire in this life, nothing compares to the peace of Allah. We can have all wealth, all health, all youth, all beauty, all looks, all children, and yet our hearts lack peace. Allah says, what you and I need is peace, but not any peace, the peace of Allah, which means getting His tranquility, serenity, illumination for our hearts, healing, joy, fulfillment, that you might not even have much in your life, and yet your heart is feeling content. That's peace from Allah. Salamun qawlan min Rabbir Rahim. And it will be uttered to them in Jannah when Allah greets the people of Jannah saying, Salamun alaykum, Salamun alaykum. Imagine the moment when you and I hear Allah saying to us, Salamun alaykum. Allah doesn't just say it in words. When He renders His peace, when He says it, it means I'm going to cast it and enfold it upon you, or enfold you into it, surround you and immerse you completely into My peace. And imagine when the peace of Allah comes to you and me. I'm going to conclude with this. In these last nights of Ramadan, and we know we're in the beginning part of the last 10 nights of Ramadan, we're promised Laylatul Qadr, brothers and sisters. Promised Laylatul Qadr, a night like no other. A night that Allah describes in Surah Al-Qadr, in which He says, it's better than all time, better than 1,000 months. A night that is witnessed by the angels who come to this earth to greet the believers and make dua for them, filling earth. A night in which Allah sends down His decree and the destinies for you and me, for our futures. So they're going to unfold on that night. We have the ability and the opportunity on that Laylatul Qadr to even alter what's going to happen to us in our futures. That's why Allah says, who's going to roll up his sleeves on that night? Do you know what Laylatul Qadr is? He says in the surah, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ. It's a night that you and I, if we missed it, Rasulullah says, we've missed all good. Imagine, all good, and we're going to be miserable and deprived. May Allah not make us deprived. May Allah make us attain it. But I'm going to tell you something about Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr is a night of two things. Afu of Allah, the pardon of Allah, what's called Afu, and Salam. At the end of the surah, Allah says, Salamun hiya hatta matla' al-fajr. It's a night of total peace from Allah. Total peace of Allah. What did I just say about Surah Yasin? Allah greets the people of Jannah with His peace and sends His peace upon them, the greatest thing we can attain. is the peace of Allah. And Allah promises Laylatul Qadr is a night in which all your du'as will be answered. You're going to be completely fulfilled. But the greatest gift Allah can give us is His peace. To enfold us completely in peace. And it can stay with you for the rest of the journey of life if Allah delivers it to you and me. And one more thing that this man experienced, the man who died, one act he did, keep in mind, one act he did transformed his life completely and put him in Jannah. One act. So it wasn't in the quantity of the deeds. Allah forgave all of his sins of the past and pardoned him completely. So there's this concept of afu. So I'll conclude with this. Rasulullah was asked by Aisha. Aisha was concerned about Laylatul Qadr. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, what should I say? What should I ask for? Because my needs are many. If there's one thing to ask, what should I ask? And Rasulullah said, Ya Aisha, if you come upon that night, say this one dua that we've all memorized. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anni. So I'm going to send it in the chat box right now. So I just send it to you in Arabic. It's translated and transliterated. Memorize it. These are the words of our beloved Rasulullah. I'm going to translate it for you. It's saying, Ya Allah, you are afu. Afu is the name of Allah. You love to do afu, so do afu to me. So what is afu? Usually it's translated as forgiveness. And I'm going to tell you, it's not just forgiveness. It's different than forgiveness. Forgiveness means to veil a sin, to conceal it. But it doesn't mean that the sin was wiped from your record. Afu means Allah will come and wipe the sins completely from your record and from the memory of the angels. You're not going to even be questioned about it ever. It's as if it never happened. That's the promise of Allah on that night. And on top of this, afu means He's going to be so pleased with you that He'll start to give you from His bounties and His gifts without you even asking. That's why He said to Aisha, Rasulullah, Aisha, just ask for afu. Because even if you don't know what to ask, Allah will fulfill all of your needs, even the needs you don't know about, because He's so generous. So when you invoke Allah with this, you're saying Afu, it's one of His names. One of the names of Allah is Al-Afu. So you're saying, Ya Allah, the Afu, who loves to wipe out the sins and grant from His bounties, and it is You who gives His pleasure, essentially. You're asking for all these things within one word, Afu. You're invoking Him with it, and you're saying, Ya Allah, I'm poor, give it to me. So it's a very encompassing dua. So I conclude with this. Brothers and sisters, when you say this dua in the coming nights, make sure you utter the dua a lot. From the time of Maghrib and for the rest of the night until dawn. Keep saying this dua, memorize it, understand what it means, invoke Allah. But when you invoke Allah, bring a heart to Allah that is yearning, that feels the need and the poverty, that feels the hope in Allah. A heart that shows gratitude to Allah for being afu. And you're saying, Ya Allah, I love You for being afu. Grant me, Ya Allah. Shower me with Your afu, Ya Allah. You promised this. Shower my family and my children. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, if you put your hand on the ground with sujood, cry out to Allah with this dua, believing in it, believing in His afu, and appreciating His beauty and His afu, and saying, Ya Allah, I need it. I'm Your servant. Watch what Allah will do for you. You'll witness astounding, astonishing changes and transformations in your life. We ask Allah to grant it His afu. Again, share this dua with others and you'll get the reward, inshallah. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Ameen, ameen. Barakallahu feekum. Back to you, inshallah, Anas.
Over to you.
So we stopped in ayah 27. I read some from ayah 27 to ayah 77. We read like the rest of it, inshallah. And then we gonna conclude with dua, inshallah. Bismillah. أَوَلَمْ يَرَ الْإِنسَانُ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ فَإِذَا هُوَ خَصِيمٌ وضرب لنا مثلا ونسي خلقه قال من يحيي العظام وهي رميم
الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم الذي جعل لكم من الشجر الأخضر نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون أوليس الذي خلق السماوات والأرض بقادر على مثلهم بل وهو الخلاق العليم إنما فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء 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 وإليه ترجعون اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم اغفر لنا ما مضى وبارك لنا فيما بقى واجعل صيامنا مقبولا وذنبنا مغفورا وسعينا مشكورا اللهم أمد لنا في عمرنا وأحسن في أعمالنا وجعلنا مباركين أينما كنا اللهم أحاطت بنا ذنوبنا وأغرقتنا خطايانا فاغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا اللهم إن اعترفنا بذنوبنا وأقررنا بخطايانا اغفر لنا كل ذنب واستر علينا كل عيب اغفر لنا ذنوبنا كلها أولها وآخرها علانيتها وسرها اللهم إنا نسألك إيمانا نهتدي به ونورا نقتدي به ورزقا حلالا نكتفي به اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وبجودك وكرمك عمن سواك وارزقنا من حيث لا نحتسب. اللهم اغفر لآبائنا وأمهاتنا، اللهم ارحمهم كما ربونا صغارا. اللهم من كان فيهم حيا فزده طاعة ونعيما وعافية. اللهم متعنا وأقر أعيننا ببر آبائنا وأمهاتنا. اللهم فأنزل على قبرهم الضياء والنور. اللهم اجمعنا ووالدينا على سرر متقابلين في جنات النعيم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اغفر لأمواتنا وأموات المسلمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا المصطفى وحبيبنا المجتبى سيدنا محمد عليه الصلاة والسلام. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.
You are the most bountiful, you are the most beneficent, you are the creator and sustainer of the heavens and the earth. To you we belong, Ya Allah, and to you we return. We beseech Ya Allah and ask you by your beautiful names and your beautiful attributes, Ya Allah, that you make the Quran the light of our hearts, that the light of our chests and the light of our hearts, Ya Allah, and a means for relieving us of our afflictions and distress, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, make us reach Laylatul Qadr. You are the most bountiful. You are the light of the heavens and the earth. We beseech you, Allah, and ask you and beg you, Allah, to not make us among those who are deprived of Laylatul Qadr, Ya Allah. Grant us, Ya Allah, Laylatul Qadr. Make us witness the bounty and the beauty and the mercy that you place within Laylatul Qadr, Ya Allah. Grant us your forgiveness and your pardon in Laylatul Qadr, Ya Allah. Fulfill our needs, Ya Allah, on Laylatul Qadr. Ya Allah, bless us and heal us and our families and our children and our parents and our community, Ya Allah. Make that layla, Ya Allah, that night a means for relieving this earth from its afflictions, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, make it a night of change, of transformation, of healing, of relief, Ya Allah. Make it a night of changing our lives, Ya Allah. You are capable and powerful over all things. We're your servants, Ya Allah, and our forelocks are in your hands, Ya Allah. We're poor, we're miserly, Ya Allah. We're needy, Ya Allah. We're your poor servants, Ya Allah, and all that we need is your pleasure, Ya Allah. Grant us your pleasure, Ya Allah, and make us content with your decree, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, guide us and guide our hearts, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, you are pardoning. You love to pardon. Pardon us, Ya Allah. You are afu. You love to deliver afu, Ya Allah. Grant us your afu. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'afu anna. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Barakallahu fikum.